To today's live broadcast, evaluation of neutrophil lymphocyte ratio as an indicator of chronic distress in the laboratory rodent, presented by Debra Hickman, DVM, Director, Laboratory Animal Resource Center, Indiana University. I am Christina Mahalik of LabRoots, and I'll be your moderator for today's event. We are delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by LabRoots. LabRoots is the leading scientific social networking website and producer of educational virtual events and webinars. Before we begin, I would like to remind everyone that this event is interactive. We encourage you to participate by submitting as many questions as you want at any time you want during the presentation. Just click on the Ask a Question box located on the far left of your screen and type your questions into the drop-down box that appears on the screen. We'll answer as many questions as we have time for at the end of the presentation. If you have trouble seeing or hearing the presentation, please click on the Help Desk button located in the promotional board at the bottom center of your screen, or use the Ask a Question box to let us know you're having a problem. This presentation is educational and thus offers continuing education credits. Please click on the accreditation button located in the promotional board at the bottom center of your screen and follow the process to obtain your credits. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Hickman. I will now turn the presentation over to her. Dr. Hickman?
I'd like to start off today by talking about, well, why do we measure animal well-being? This is a good question for us because it drives a whole bunch of the research that we do. The obvious answer is that we want happy, healthy animals, because happy, healthy animals mean better science, more reliable results, and actually improving the health and well-being of animals and people, which is everybody's ultimate goal. So how do we normally achieve this goal of happy, healthy animals? The biggest thing that we do in the laboratory animal world is we try and decrease stress. We try and minimize and prevent pain and distress wherever we can throughout all of our handling of the animals that we house. However, we do have to be careful and remember that not all stress is bad. Life is full of good stress and it's full of bad stress. And the most important thing that we have to do is come up with a balance between the two of those, preferably with good stress being more frequent than bad stress. A nice illustration of how this works is that we try and find a balance in these three categories. We want in the basic health and functioning, we want a healthy animal or person who's able to engage in natural living, their normal behaviors, and has a positive affective state. And that means that they're feeling happy, optimistic, not pessimistic or negative. This Venn diagram was put together by David Fraser, and it's one we use a lot when we're talking about animal well-being, and you'll see it a few more times during this presentation today. So as an example of how we try and balance these three things, when we're deciding how we're going to take care of rodents in the laboratory animal facility, we first start looking at their natural living environments. Rodents typically live in burrows, and they engage in social interactions, make nests and other things like that. This would be a typical wild rodent housing situation. And this, of course, is the typical laboratory housing situation, which is quite different. So in an animal facility, it can be difficult to try and extrapolate that natural living. However, it's not impossible. As I said, these rodents burrow, they build nests, they forage, they nod, and they have social groups. So some of the enrichment strategies that we've used over the years include providing deep bedding to allow burrowing, nesting materials to allow nesting, supplementary diets that can allow them to forage, chewing toys, and then social housing for their comfort. But this is a question that my laboratory struggles with very extensively. Do we know if these strategies work? Frequently, these strategies are making us happy, but are they making the animals happy? And that's the question that we try to answer, and it becomes a very difficult question. To kind of give you an example of that, I want to share a classic example. Most of you are probably familiar with this environmental enrichment device. It's a mouse igloo with a running wheel on it. It's very popular because it gives those rodents exercise, gives them a chance to run and have a lot of good cardiovascular activity, prevent boredom in the cage, all sorts of other things like that. but it's not a one-size-fits-all solution for all laboratory rodents and mice. There is a classic study that showed that when you put this cage, when you put this running wheel in a cage with rodents that were highly aggressive, a highly aggressive strain of mouse, basically by putting that that running wheel into the cage with these mice, as you can see in this cartoon, the one mouse on the right is saying, this could get interesting. You were basically handing them a pair of nunchucks and a gun, because what you did was you gave these rodents something that they could fight over, a valuable resource that instead of enriching their lives created a lot of fighting and damage and injuries to the animals that were within the cage. So this is an obvious example of an enrichment gone wrong, but it's not the only one. And there is a lot of value in making sure that we're looking for subtle differences that are causing distress and making sure that we're giving the animals resources that they have value, that have value for them. So how do we measure animal well-being in the laboratory animal rodents? I'm going to focus today on acute versus chronic stress responses, and I put those words in quotations because it is they're not firm definitions of acute versus chronic, and you'll see that as we go forward. These are the things that we typically look at when we're looking at animal welfare issues. We're going to start with the acute stress response, and as you can see, this could range from a response that happens in a matter of seconds to minutes, and even that definition can be stretched to include a couple of days too. So that's why that acute is in quotations. These would be what we would consider the most traditional methods of stress response. And when we're looking at acute stress, the response that we're measuring is the HPA response. We have a stimulus, a fight or flight stimulus that triggers the hypothalamus to release hormones, which then stimulate the pituitary and the adrenals to ultimately result in a release of glucocorticoids and catecholamines. That stress response is what we call the fight or flight, but it is worth noting that that stress response is triggered in negative situations like the fight or flight, but it's also triggered in positive situations. So we have to be careful in looking at just those endocrine responses when we're interpreting what's going on with the animal. But this acute stress response does give us some tools that we can look for, use when we're looking at measuring if there's been an acute stressor of some sort. So in this group, we have things like measuring serum norepinephrine levels, the levels of ACTH that are produced by the animal, the levels of corticosterone, most rapidly in the blood or serum, but also through collection of feces and other things like that. Blood glucose can also give us some information about the acute stress response because blood glucose is mobilized as part of that fight or flight response. And then we can actually look at active behavioral responses, meaning how does the animal's behavior change after having that stress response. So these are the measures that we typically use for acute stress responses. However, they're not very useful for chronic measures. I do, before I go on in a little more detail, wanted to take a moment and point out that pain is also something else that we look for, and that the mouse grimace scale would be another example of an acute measure of pain or distress that goes on to the order of a little bit more like days as opposed to seconds to minutes, but it's not really a chronic because hopefully that this state for the animal isn't extending for long periods of time. I threw this in here just to make sure we all don't forget that pain is a component of an acute stress response as well. So I like this next slide because it does drive home the fact that you have positive stressors and negative stressors. So in the, at the first arrow, you have what is basically a negative stress response happened. And so it's pushed the valence down into the negative one. And then the body pushes back its correcting mechanisms, its negative feedback, and then we go back to a homeostasis environment. But then the next arrow is actually a positive stress response. So in this case, you get the similar trigger of the HPA axis, but you also, but at this time it's in a positive direction, not in a negative direction. That would be a eustressor. But again, it goes back to homeostasis. And so this is what we want. We want a response to the stressor, and then we want the return back to the optimum state of homeostasis. And this works well when that correcting mechanism is in place and those negative feedback loops are working. What happens in a situation of chronic distress where we start to have problems is you have a trigger of that fight or flight response, that you have your perceived threat, as shown in this slide. You have the fight or flight response, and then for whatever reason, you don't return to homeostasis, but you stay at that amped up state of chronic stress. And this is what we're trying to avoid in our research situation. This would be the bad stress. And these would be examples of sequelae that happen after you've had a lot of bad stress or you've had chronic bad stress. So we see things like cardiovascular disease associated with chronic distress. We see things like anxiety, weight gain, insomnia, GI problems, premature aging. People and animals who are subject to chronic stress have increased infections. They have higher cancer rates. These are all things we recognize in our species, and they definitely hold in the laboratory rodents as well. So let's take a moment and talk about our chronic stress assessment. So these chronic stress measurements would be more appropriate when you're asking a research question that's looking at how something in the animal's environment is affecting them over a longer period of time. And this longer period of time could be hours to days to weeks to months. And this is the kind of stress assessment that we're looking for when we're looking at how, for example, housing or environmental enrichment improves animals' well-being. So the traditional methods that we've used for this kind of assessment are typically pretty obvious methods. We look at reproductive success. We know that one of the first things to go with an animal if it's very stressed out is reproduction. If you're trying to struggle to stay alive, reproducing the next generation takes a lot of resources, and you're probably not going to put those resources into reproduction if you're trying to keep yourself alive. So reproductive success has been a metric that we've used to determine whether the well-being of animals is good or not, but it's not necessarily the most sensitive one. We've also looked at growth curves and body weight loss and other things like that. These can give you some information. If an animal is not gaining weight the way conspecifics of a similar age are, that can give you some evidence that that animal might be experiencing some stress. There are some other measurements that you can use that are in our toolbox for chronic stress assessment. Those include glucose and corticosterone, systemic changes like the weight loss that I just referenced. Organ weights can give you some information. Adrenals and thymus and spleen often change size relative to the body weight depending on if an animal is stressed or not. So that can give you some information, although clearly that's an end-of-life assessment, which may not be useful in a long-term study. We can also do things like passive behavioral assessment where we observe the animal in the cage and see if there's any behaviors that have changed up away from the animal's ethogram, expected ethogram. We can also do active behavioral assessments just as we do for acute stress assessment, putting them in an elevated plus maze, Moore's water maze, examining things like learning and things like that. Now, one thing I want to point out here is that corticosterone and glucose are on both of my slides, and that is because these are very easy to measure things in some cases, but they're also very much integrally tied into the fight or flight response and that HPA stimulation. But there's a big caution that we have to have about using corticosterone and blood glucose, and that's because they are such an inherent part of our physiology. And they fluctuate based on so many different factors, it can be very difficult to extrapolate what you're seeing just simply from looking at a corticosterone level or a blood glucose level. And like in this slide, you can see that there's definitely, this is an example of a cortisol cycle, but you can see there's definite peaks that are associated with different times of the day, and that you can see that there's variation that occurs on whether you've been fed or not, whether the animal or person has just eaten recently. We also know that there's sex differences, there's seasonality, there's a multitude of factors that can compromise your interpretation about corticosterone and blood glucose. Further complicating that is in an attempt to reduce distressed animals, we frequently will use alternative methods of measuring corticosterone as opposed to taking a blood sample because a blood sample is fairly invasive. So we'll do things like look at corticosterone levels in saliva or feces, or hair. And in those methods of measuring corticosterone, you actually have now a time delay effect too, which can be extremely variable. And you have to try and figure out how to, for example, take into account GI mobility and how that might have affected the levels of corticosterone that you're seeing in the feces of the animal that you're evaluating. So All in all, these can be very frustrating to try and use. Plus, because they also spike with an acute stressor, you're never quite certain whether you're actually measuring the chronic stressor or if you're measuring the response to the acute stressor. For example, are you measuring the response of restraining the animal and collecting a blood sample, or are you actually measuring the response that you're hoping to, which is how that new housing environment affected the animal's life? So, as we realize that there's all these complications and all these limitations, especially with corticosterone and the blood glucose, our lab started looking at a better tool for assessment. And we hit the literature, and we were intrigued by a paper that we found by Gelling in 2010. And they were using a leukocyte coping capacity assay, and they used it in prairie voles and river voles. And it was actually a very interesting study. So what you did was you collected a blood sample, and then you treated it to cause a respiratory burst. So you basically pretended that you were insulting the neutrophils in the blood sample with a bacterial exposure, and then you measured the response of those neutrophils to that fake bacterial exposure. And in their hands, this correlated very well to a stressed animal, to being able to differentiate a stressed animal from a non-stressed animal. So we were quite excited by this technique, even though it required some pretty specialized equipment and some interesting chemicals. So we did a study that looked at this in mice, in laboratory mice and rats, and we found that it did not work at all in our laboratory rodents. And that surprised us because it's been used in a wide variety of species. This paper with voles was not the only one that had used this. But in our studies, the rats and the mice that were stressed were absolutely no different than the mice and the rats that were non-stressed. So we did a second arm of this study where we looked at mice that came from a pet store. And what we found is those animals actually did show the same response that the voles had reported for the voles and for other more wild type creatures. So that led us to suspect that perhaps our animals are probably just a little bit too clean in the biomedical research field. We've worked really hard to keep them free of pathogens and free of immune stimulation, which means that we do typically see a bit lower white blood cell counts, and probably that translates into lower neutrophils and then less of a response to be able to monitor with this leukocyte coping capacity. So we were a little discouraged because we thought we'd found a great tool, but it didn't actually work. So we went back to the drawing board to try and come up with a better tool for assessment for chronic distress. And what we did was we went back to this slide talking about the chronic problems that occur with a highly triggered, stuck fight or flight response, chronic distress. And what you notice is that there is definitely an immune system issue, which is premise behind the leukocyte coping capacity assay as well. If you're highly stressed, you're going to see increases in infections because you actually have immune suppression going on within your body. So we took another look at the white blood cell counts, and what happens very consistently across species is that chronic immunosuppression presents as a neutrophilia. So you see those neutrophil numbers go up, and there may or may not be a concurrent lymphopenia going on at the same time. Now, the overall total white blood cell count stays the same, but what you see is this left shift, that the neutrophils go up and the lymphocytes may or may not go down. And what intrigued us is that this is not only seen just with chronic distress, but you can also see it with other clinical conditions that are associated with chronically elevated cortisol, such as Cushing's syndrome, and you can also see it in mental disorders such as schizophrenia, depression, and mania. So times when the mind and body are completely out of balance, these patients present with this very similar neutrophilia plus or minus that concurrent lymphopenia. Looking at the literature, we found that this had been used in a wide variety of species. So it had been reported as to be a good way of measuring distress in dolphins and horses and guinea pigs and sows and cattle. So we thought that this might be promising for our laboratory rodents, but again, given the problems that we'd had with the leukocyte coping capacity, we were a little nervous because we know that our laboratory rodents are not necessarily immunologically the same as these other species. So we set out to characterize this assay in laboratory rats and mice. Now, the advantage to the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio is that it doesn't require significant numbers of these white blood cells. It's a ratio. So to calculate it, you take the total number of neutrophils and you divide it by the total number of lymphocytes. Very simple. And it's also relatively inexpensive and simple to perform. So you can use an automated machine like the machine on the right in the slide, or you can do your CBC count by hand and actually get your red blood cell count and your white blood cell counts manually. So you have these opportunities to do this. It doesn't require specialized equipment, and the math is very, very simple. So this was very intriguing for us, and we really hoped that this assay would work because this would have many advantages over the corticosterone and leukocyte coping capacity. So we started with rats, and we did a two-phase study. In the first phase, we looked at restraint stress, which was an acute stress, and then we used both sprigged dolly males and females in that study. And then we looked at a daily stress, a more chronic stress study. We used only sprigged dolly males for this study. For those males, they were stressed every day for about 7 days. Their stressors were things like a couple of hours in a moistened cage where the bedding was kind of wet, a few hours in a cage that was tilted at about 30 degrees, some time in a smaller cage. So instead of a rat cage, they were put into a mouse-sized cage. So they were a little more constrained in their ability to move and engage in normal behaviors. And the key here was that all of these stressors were uncontrolled and unpredictable. So they had one stressor a day, but it came at a different time during the day, and it was always a different stressor. That way they could not anticipate what might be coming their direction, which is it's a classic way to stimulate stress. So what we found is when we looked at the acute restraint study, so where we just temporarily restrained a rat for about 60 seconds and then let it go, we didn't see any differences in our total white blood cell count between our restrained and our non-restrained rats. There were no differences in the neutrophils, total neutrophils, or the total lymphocytes. And there were actually, our neutrophil lymphocyte ratio had no differences between the non-restrained rats and the restrained rats. However, we did see a very significant difference between the serum corticosterone levels between our restrained and our non-restrained rats. And as you can see in this slide, the non-restrained rats had a serum corticosterone level of approximately 143, while the restrained rats were up at 215 approximately. So we did definitely see an acute stress response, but that acute stress response did not translate into the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio because that ratio is about 0.44 and 0.4 for those two categories with no statistically significant difference. And this is what we expected. The neutrophil lymphocyte ratio takes some time, and that's why it's a good measurement of a chronic stress. So we expected serum corticosterone to be more sensitive for the acute restraint part of this study than we did for the chronic stress. When we looked at our animals who'd undergone the daily stressors, what we found was a little bit interesting, and this is what we were very much hoping for. Again, there were no differences in the total white blood cell counts or total neutrophils or total lymphocyte counts for these animals. But when we looked at the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio and the serum corticosterone levels between the non-stressed rats and the daily stressed rats, we did see a significant difference in the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio between these two groups. The non-stressed rats had a neutrophil lymphocyte ratio of approximately 0.24, whereas the stressed rats had an elevated one of 0.32, and that was a statistically significant difference. Of interest, their serum corticosterone levels were not significantly different, which goes to further show why this could be a little bit more, why that measure could be a little problematic, and the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio might be a little bit more reliable of an assay for chronic distress. Because we're looking at this valence and the interaction between basic health and functioning, normal behavior, and affective state, one of the rules of our lab is that thou shalt never perform a welfare study that evaluates only one component. So by looking at the immune system, we're really only looking at basic health and functioning and physiology. So we really need to look at one of these other two to make sure that we've got the valence correct. So we either need to look at natural living and natural behaviors, or we need to look at the affective state of these animals to make sure that although we're seeing a difference between those two groups, were the animals really and truly distressed? So the behavioral test that we chose for this study was looking, we used a spatial cognitive bias assay that's designed to measure the affective state of rats. And briefly, what you do for this behavioral assessment is you train the rats to distinguish between the black dot on the left side of the slide and the white dot on the right side of the slide. You train them that when the goal pod is in the location of the black dot, there's a treat that they cannot access. So there's a goal pod that they enter, there's a screen, and their little Fruit Loop that they want to eat is on the other side of the screen. So they can see it, smell it, but they just can't get to it. When the goal pod's in the white location, you have the goal pod and the Fruit Loops are on top of the screen, so they get a food reward when they enter that goal pod. And what we do is we train them until they're showing us that they can tell the difference between those two locations by rapidly running to the white spot when the goal pod's at the white spot, but delaying their time and or not even entering when the goal pod's at the black spot. Once they're doing that, we can change up something in these animals' environment, and then we can come back and probe them in a test phase. And that's where the three gray dots are in this schematic. So we put the goal pod not quite in the non-rewarded location or not quite in the rewarded location or in a point exactly in between those two locations, and we ask the rat to make a judgment call on how sure they are that even though it's not quite in the right place, that treat will be accessible or not. And this system's been used by a number of labs, and it's actually a very nice way of measuring a positive affective state or optimism as compared to a negative affective state or pessimism in rats. So with this study, when we did our probe for these two groups of animals, the stressed versus the non-stressed, we found that we did have a significant increase in the time to approach for our non-rewarded, the just off of non-rewarded pot location in the rats that had been stressed daily. So what this suggests to us is that our physiologic and immunologic data with the increase in the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio is actually and truly reflecting that these animals were in a negative affective state and not in a happy situation. So they were pessimistic rats, as evidenced in our behavioral tests too. So with these results, we were able to publish a paper, and you can see the reference there, in 2014 that strongly recommended using the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio as a measure of chronic distress in rats. We next repeated this study in mice because mice are not rats and rats are not mice, and what works in mice may work in rats, and what works in rats may or may not work in mice. So this time we did the daily stressor. We did not do the acute stress phase of the study. We just did the daily mild stressors, and we used C57 black 6N mice, males and females, for this study. And in this case, the mild daily stressors for the mice included being put on a shaking platform and just kind of gently shaken for a couple of hours. They did a very brief, less than 1 minute forced swim periodically. We put them under a little bit of a heat stress where they were put under heat lamps that got them up to approximately 85 degrees. And again, uncontrolled, a single stressor a day, but at different times of the day, so they just never quite knew what was coming their direction to induce that mild distress. So our results of this study, again, we didn't see any differences in the white blood cell counts, the neutrophils, or the lymphocytes. And I should point out, too, this is important because what this tells us is that we didn't have animals that were having a response to an infection or anything like that. You want to see the ratio change. You don't want to see the overall number of white blood cells change. So that's what you're looking for in double-checking the white blood cells, neutrophils, and lymphocyte, total neutrophils and lymphocytes. When we looked at their serum corticosterone level, for our mice, we actually had an interesting little difference here. Our females exhibited no statistically significant difference in their serum corticosterone levels, whether they were stressed or non-stressed. Both of those groups were identical for the girls. But our males had a significant increase if they were stressed in their corticosterone as compared to the non-stressed males. So we did, in our males at least, we saw there was a corticosterone response to those mild daily stressors, but that wasn't present in our females. When we looked at our neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, overall, we did see a significant increase in the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio for the animals that had gone through the daily stressors as compared to the animals that were not stressed on a daily basis. And of interest, there was no sex difference in this, which might suggest that our females actually might have been a little more stressed than the serum corticosterone was picking up, since their responses were more similar to the males when you looked at the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. Now, again, we have to look at this valence. We have to make sure that we're measuring, looking at the valence of this response, and that we're making sure that we're actually measuring distress versus eustress. So we did, a behavioral study for this one. For our mice, instead of doing affective state, because affective state of the mouse has been a little more difficult to get at, we used an elevated plus maze so we could look at behavior and their behavioral responses in response to the stress. And what we found is, so with the elevated plus maze, an animal who's a little more relaxed will spend more time out exploring the open arm, whereas an animal that's feeling more anxiety and more unhappiness with their situation is going to spend more time in the closed arms. And as you can see from this slide, our non-stress mice spent a lot more time, their proportion of time on the open arms was about 0.21 as compared to the daily stressed mice, which were 0.11. And then they had many more open entries into the open arm. Their proportion of entries into the open arm was 0.34 as compared to 0.27 for the stressed animals. So again, we were able to demonstrate that the physiologic changes we were seeing with the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio were not unique. They're confirmed by the behavioral testing that we were seeing. So this meant success. We're quite happy that the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio does appear to be a very robust tool for assessing chronic stress in both laboratory rats and mice. And when you couple it with behavioral testing, it can give you very valuable information regarding that valence of this distress or eustress. And then it has the absolutely wonderful advantage in that it's relatively simple and inexpensive to perform. It doesn't require specialized equipment or multiple chemicals to be on hand or anything like that. It's something that we can do with the tools that most of us have actually very easily at our disposal. So to give you an example of how this tool can be used to help explain valence and help you sort out more information about chronic distress, I wanted to share another one of our studies with you. This is a study that we looked at to evaluate multi-level housing for rats. And in this multi-level caging system, you have a shelf that allows the animals, the rats, to be able to climb up onto an upper level and access the top part of that cage. They also have the bottom area, which is usually bedded, and that can be used for sleeping, although, interestingly, in our experience, they like sleeping on the shelf a little bit more than the bedding. What we did in this study is we wanted to see if we restricted them to just the bottom of the cage as opposed to giving them access to the full multi-level cage. How did that affect the animal's well-being? And so in the picture on the right, you can see an example of the barrier that we put in place that would prevent the animals from going from the bottom part of the cage up to the top level of the cage. In the actual study, there was not yellow tape on that. That yellow tape is there just for to allow people to visualize where the shelf was a little bit better. But what this did was it basically took this cage, which is approximately 30 inches tall, and brought it back down to about 15 inches tall, so more in line with a standard rat housing cage. So, again, we used our cognitive bias, our spatial recognition cognitive bias assessment, and we trained our rats to make that discrimination between the rewarded location and the unrewarded location. And then what we did is we changed their environment. So we had five different groups of rats in this study. And I'm gonna start with the two bars on the right, because those are the most interesting ones from the cognitive bias status. So the tallest bar, the second from the right, represents the rats that had started with full access to the entire cage. They could access both levels. And then after they showed that they could do the spatial discrimination assay, we put that barrier in place so that they were restricted just to the lower half of the cage. And what you see is their latency times increased. So they became much more pessimistic about entering that goal pot because their affective state was more in a negative affective state than it had been previously. So by taking away that extra access to the additional space, we saw that these animals basically became more depressed. The bar to the right is the animals who had started in the restricted access, and then after they showed that they could tell the spatial discrimination assay, we removed the barrier and they had access to the full cage. And you can see that their latency times to enter the goal pods dropped significantly. So they were on the average of, I think it looks like, about 22 seconds, which is really fast. So by giving these animals access to the full cage, they became very optimistic. They were in a positive affective state. So this was good. We wanted to show that the animals did appreciate the change in the environment. So what's interesting, though, is so if you look at the black bar on the far left, is rats who were housed consistently throughout this entire study in standard micro-isolator caging for rats. So no glass barrier or no plastic barrier between a top and a bottom, just your typical rodent housing. The light gray bar just to the right of that one was animals that were allowed full access to the full multi-level cage the entire time of the study. And then the third bar was animals that were kept in the restricted part of the cage during the entire study. And what's interesting is those three bars show no difference in our cognitive bias assay. And so if you stopped right here, you would be kind of forced to say, well, yes, if they hadn't had access and you gave them access, their latency times increased, so they seemed happier. Or if they had access and you removed access to the top part of the cage, you depressed them some by put them in a negative affective state. But if they'd been hanging out in this cage, whichever cage environment they'd been in for the 2 to 3 weeks that it takes to do all this behavioral testing, there was no difference. So why would you do that? And what's happened here is that these animals have habituated, and this goes back to that requirement for us to go back to homeostasis. We cannot stay in a significantly positive state of mind all the time, nor can we stay in a significantly negative state of mind all the time. And my illustration for this study is the ones who went from the full access to restricted access would be similar to us being out in our daily lives and then being arrested and put into jail. You've now been restricted, and being in jail is going to make you depressed, and it's going to stress you out, and it's going to make your life very difficult. But physiologically and mentally, you can't stay in that state forever or you'll die. We do have to learn to cope with the situations that we have. Likewise, that bar with on the far right, where the animals that had restricted access and now have access to the full cage, these were like you just won the lottery and you get to go stay at the Ritz within the presidential suite and you have your own butler and everything's paid for and it's all wonderful and your life is great. But after a few days to a week, you're going to be starting to take it for granted, not value it quite so much, because again, you're habituating to your situation. So we looked at that, and you have to try and explain what's going on with those rats that were fully in the restricted access and why they're not any different from the rats who are in the full access cage continuously. So this is where we looked at our blood work, and this is why we always look at more than one parameter when we're doing a welfare study. And what we found is if you look just at those three groups, the controls who were in a standard shoebox cage, the ones who had access to the full cage, or the ones who had access to the just to the bottom part of the cage, you found that there was really no difference in the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio between the standard shoebox cage and the rats that were provided access to the full cage. They both were around 0.27 neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. But our restricted access guys, the ones who had that barrier between them and the whole cage, chronically throughout the entire study, had a neutrophil lymphocyte ratio of approximately 0.32. So we did see an elevation in their neutrophil lymphocyte ratio that suggested that they were a bit more stressed out than the rats that were in our control situation. And this could be, we speculate that this could be because the control situation actually had no place else that they could look at, whereas these guys, because they had a plastic barrier and you actually could see that there was additional cage up above you, might have been a little bit more stressed out, and that might have driven that. But even though there were no behavioral differences, if we go back to this slide, between those three groups, there were no behavioral differences on this cognitive bias assay, but there were very clear physiologic differences that helped explain some of that information. So this is an example of how you can use the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio in the manner that you would typically use a corticosterone level to try and explain a little bit more about what's happening with these animals. So in conclusion, we've demonstrated that the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio is definitely a robust measure of chronic distress for laboratory rats and mice, and it's relatively inexpensive and simple to perform, which makes it a very valuable tool for a welfare assessment profile. With that, I'd like to acknowledge my co-authors on all this work, Melissa Swan, Jessica Peebler, and Arnell Wheeler. We're all instrumental in the collection of all of this work. And if there are any questions, I'd be happy to take them.
The difference in the corticosterone in the chronically stressed rats and mice.
Yeah, so the question was, why do we think that we did not see a difference in the corticosterone in the chronically stressed rats and mice? One of the reasons I think that we were dealing with the corticosterone is that there were definite sex differences. We do know that sex can be a contributing factor to variation between levels of corticosterone. And especially what we found in the mice when we went back and talked through our study, it was actually very interesting that we found that the stressors that we'd chosen for the female mice, they actually seemed to take them as an improvement of their well-being. So while the males seemed to be a little bit stressed by being put in a cage that was 85 degrees, the girls took a nap. And the literature actually does kind of suggest that females are more stressed by social stressors, whereas males are more stressed by physical stressors. So we do think that some of our sex differences and some of those differences were due to the selection of the stressors that we used.
Thank you. That's very interesting. Thank you so much. Our second question asks, why do we think there are a sex difference in the mouse serum corticosterone, but not the rats?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. And so I think part of it is, well, we didn't actually look at the sex difference in the rats. But that would be a very interesting question. And we're wondering, because of that same thing of stressing them as far as social stressors being of more important to the female animals as opposed to the male animals, that might drive those differences. But yeah, a lot of it was choosing the right kind of stressors for those. But the question about the females and they're not being stressed, although, like I said, it was very interesting that even though the females did not show significant elevations in their serum corticosterone levels as compared to the males, the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio was still there. They still had those differences. So that difference was still robust.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your answer. It appears our last question for the day is, asks, would this work in other species?
That is a great question. And yeah, I think it definitely would. Like I said, we got excited about this because we noticed that it had been done in a wide variety of species, including guinea pigs. So it had already been done in a typical laboratory animal rodent. So we do have every expectation that it would be a good one to use for any species, non-human primates, dogs, cats, rabbits, et cetera. I just would say that because of the problems that we had with the lymphocyte coping capacity, I would try and characterize it before I used it widely, but there seems to be a growing body of evidence that this is a very much conserved response in mammals, which would suggest that it would be a useful assay for any of our laboratory animal species.
Well, thank you once again. I would like to thank Dr. Hickman for her presentation. I would also like to thank LabRoots for making today's educational webcast possible. Before we go, I want to let everyone know that today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through May of 2018. You will receive an email from LabRoots letting you know when this webcast will be available for replay. Please share that announcement with your colleagues who may have missed today's live event. That's all for now. Thank you for joining us at LabRoots, and we hope to see you here again soon. Goodbye.